Thank you so much for joining today's webinar. Very excited to have today's speakers. Today's webinar is Integrating Fish Physiology, Habitat, and Climate Models to Design Aquatic Conservation Strategies. A couple of housekeeping rules. If you would like to ask questions, you can select the hand icon next to your name in the GoToWebinar control panel, and then I will unmute you and you can ask your question. We'll have a natural break in today's webinar where you're all invited to ask questions. Alternatively, you can type your question in the GoToWebinar control panel question box, and then I will read your question to the presenters when it's time for that. So again, you can select the hand icon, and then I'll unmute you and you can ask your question directly, or you can type your question into the box and I'll read it. I'd like to remind you also that today's webinar is available for viewing via YouTube and the Great Northern LCC website. Both those URLs are here. So I invite you and your colleagues to review this webinar many times. Pass the word. And to register for future webinars, please do go to our website, greatnorthernlcc.org. And we've got lots of really great webinars lined up, so register for those. And then I think what I'll do now is go ahead and change presenter, and I'll let Alec take the show away.
Well, welcome all. I'm Alec Maule. I'm with the Columbia River Research Lab. And actually, the title that was presented earlier for this presentation has been changed, primarily because we aren't going in the directions that we originally thought we were going to go with the project. What I'd like to do today is to give you a little bit of information about some of the climate change work that we're doing in the Columbia Basin. And then my co-presenter, Joe Benjamin, is going to talk to you a little bit about the work that has been funded to the GNLCC to do some work in the Mentau River Basin. So even though this presentation shows me as the leader, I'm really, one of many people involved in these projects, and I'm really just the talking head for the group. As you can see from this list, we've got a bunch of folks within the USGS, both at the Washington Water Science Center and here at the Columbia River Research Lab, and also a couple of people from Fort Collins, Colorado, at the USGS. And we also have collaborated with folks from the Bureau of Reclamation, from the Columbia River Intertribal Fish Commission, and also from the Yakima Nation. Joe Benjamin, as I mentioned, is one of those people that's involved in these studies, and he'll be presenting after me. So the first bit of work that we did starting about 2009 was in the Yakima River Basin. And as probably most of you already know, the Yakima River Basin is a classic East Cascade River Basin with the headwaters in the High Cascades, where we see a great deal of precipitation, most of it in the form of snow. And the mouth of the river is down in the Columbia River, basically in the desert, where it gets very little precipitation during the year. In between all of that is a great deal of agricultural land, as shown here in green. And the change in water use by the irrigation interest as well as the fisheries interest that we were interested in with our project. Another reason we chose the Yakima for this first project is that we knew that there was already some work that had been completed, including work by Mark Maston at the Washington Water Science Center, who had done some work to downscale climate change scenarios and develop watershed models for the Yakima using baseline information and also projecting into the future with climate change scenarios for the 2020s and the 2040s. We also knew that the Bureau of Reclamation had modeling availability to take these downscale watershed models and put them into a water regulation system, a river wear system. Finally, we knew that Ken Bovee and others, including Jim Hatton, who's at our lab here, had done some habitat decision support modeling as part of the Black Rock Reservoir evaluation process. We knew that we had these three pieces of information available. What we wanted to do was to add some biology. an economic analysis. First thing that we wanted to do with this project, though, was to make sure that we were answering questions that the stakeholders in the Yakima Basin were interested in having the answers to. And so we were able to work with a couple of decision analysis consultants and held a decision analysis stakeholders workshop for about a week in July of 2009. We had over 20 attendees, and these included folks from irrigation districts, local elected officials, federal, state, tribal, fish and wildlife folks, and also water managers from the Yakima Basin. As a result of this decision analysis stakeholders workshop, we ended up shifting our initial species of concern from bull trout to steelhead. And we did this because the folks in the Yakima advised us that the bull trout are up in the headwaters where water temperatures are fairly cool and regular, whereas the steelhead are down lower in the basin where water temperatures might be more of an issue. So we made the shift to steelhead, and we also added temperature modeling in the lower tributaries and the lower Yakima River. We were able to establish a collaborative agreement with the Columbia River Intertribal Fish Commission to do the modeling in the tributaries. We also developed a conceptual model of the Yakima Basin. And this is that model, fairly simplistic as you can see. If we look at this model and look at the information in the kind of pink, on the right hand, these are the objectives the water managers and stakeholders wanted to see met by water management. These are all very general, large scale sorts of objectives, such as maximizing economic benefit, maximizing environmental benefit. On the far left, in the green boxes, are the actions that the water managers can actually take. And these are, throughout this whole diagram, each of these boxes can be filled down. It's part of the software program that allows for input of data and modeling to be done. So each of these boxes may contain additional information. What we wanted to do was to try and draw a string through this conceptual model, starting with the future climate. Look at in-stream, the effects of future climate on in-stream flows, river conditions, fish health, tribal fisheries, and ultimately on economic benefit and maximum quality of life. So what I'd like to talk to you a little bit today about is some of the information we developed with stream and river conditions under these climate changes, and also the effects of these climate changes potentially on the quality of life for the Yakima tribal members. Jim Hatton did this work, and using that model that I mentioned that was put together by Ken Bovee and others. And what he did was look at the changes in potential habitat several reaches of the Yakima River. And in this particular series, he looked at the habitat available in the Gap Reach and the Wapato Reach. And these are significant because between these two reaches is the Sunnyside Diversion Dam, which will divert significant amounts of water for irrigation. And what Jim found was that there were, in fact, some changes to be expected and differences between these two reaches. If you look at these NA, that's basically the current conditions. T1 is plus 1, meaning plus 1 degree air temperature increase projected for the 2020s. And T2 is plus 2 degrees air temperature increase projected for the 2040s. And as you can see from these, the black line shows current conditions. And as we all know, the a lot of the water that in snow melts, snowmelt comes out throughout the spring, peaking kind of in late spring. However, under climate change conditions, it's expected that this snowmelt will happen much sooner, so that there will be snowmelt coming out much earlier in the year, in the winter and very early spring. And these shapes of these curves are very similar between the Gap and the Wapato. However, when we get out into the late spring and into the summer, we see that there are changes in the shapes of these curves when they start having irrigation withdrawals from the Sunnyside Diversion irrigation channel. And these diversions continue throughout the year until the flow in when the Wapato reaches the base flow, below which it cannot go for aquatic animal health. And so when this line is reached, then the irrigators cannot withdraw any more water from the 20-side diversion. This happens in August right now, perhaps late July, early August. However, under a worst-case scenario, that may happen 2 months earlier. So you can see there's a significant amount of water that won't be available for irrigators during that time. And what we wanted to do is to see what other effects may be seen in these scenarios with fish habitat. And in this case, we kind of took a cut through the middle of these curves to see what impact these changes might have on coho, salmon, fly, rearing. And what Jim did was to look at the amount of coho fly habitat, again using the BOV model, which is based on water velocity and depth. So during this time, under current conditions, 2020, 2030, and 2040 to 2050, there was actually a decrease in the amount of water that's available for the habitat in these two regions. There's a decreased amount of flow, and that decrease is lower in the Wapato reach than it is in the gap. So as you can see, actually in the gap, there was an increase in habitat available for coho fly rearing during the decrease in flows that were available. However, in the Wapato, there was a decrease in the amount of habitat that was available. So what Jim wanted to do is to see what would happen if in some way we were able to flip-flop this relationship, and that there was the changes so that there was more water available in the gap during this time and there would be less water available in the Wapato, more in the gap. And what he found was that it did make a significant difference in the amount of habitat that was available. These first graphs are the same as in the previous slide, show the increase in the gap and the decrease in the Wapato. However, if we were able to flip-flop these, we see that the amount of habitat available in the gap continued to increase through the decreased flows. And in the Wapato, while there was still a decrease in the amount of habitat available, it started at a higher level and did not go below what the current level would be in the years 2040 and 2050. And it's pretty obvious that the reason that there are these differences in how these two reaches respond to water flows is because of the different geomorphology, and that the geomorphology alters the connectivity habitat within these regions. So the next thing I'd like to tell you a little bit about is the work that Jessica Montag has been doing at Fort Collins Science Center. She was able to work with Katie Swan, who is a graduate intern and a Yakima tribal member, to put together a conceptual model of what potential there might be for climate change to impact the well-being of the Yakima tribe. Basically, what they found was, during this work, was that as far as the tribe was concerned, the treaty rights and court decisions might continue to play just as much of an important role in the tribal well-being as would future climate change. And that both of these elements will have an important impact on all of these factors dealing with the tribal well-being and the Yakima Nation. We were most concerned, of course, about first foods, especially in terms of the salmon and famine in the Yakima Basin for tribal well-being. So they put together a more involved conceptual model in which they included the elements of that are quantifiable, such as fishing success, but those that are more qualified, not quantifiable, but qualitative, in terms of the cultural meaning of fishing. At this point, Jessica and Katie are going to take this work that they've done to the tribe and conduct some interviews to make sure that the conceptual model matches with the people of the Yakima tribe and how they view the future as far as climate change is concerned. At this point, we've completed most of our work in the Yakima Basin, and we have six chapters we've put together. I've mentioned already the stakeholders workshop that we've done and the work that Jim Hatton has done with habitat. chapters, two dealing with temperature modeling, one dealing with bioenergetic impact, temperature changes on the growth and viability of fish. At this point, these six chapters are in review in the journal Climatic Change. We hope that it will be released as a special issue of the journal. Next thing I'd like to tell you a little bit about is the work that has been done under the name of the Columbia Basin Climate Change Transboundary Work Group, also known as Research to Operation. This group was put together beginning in October of 2009, and it consists of over 20 federal, state, tribal, and non-governmental organizations that were represented there. The first objective of this group was to select a climate change pilot project, one that all get behind and provide data and input to. And what was selected was to go into the Methow River Basin. And one of the main reasons that this was selected is because there was already a very big consortium of partners, and that by going into this group, into this area, we were able to leverage a good deal of work that was already going on. Excuse me for a moment. What I'd like to tell you a little bit about today is the work that was done, again, by the stakeholders workshop. This one is a little bit more extensive than what I've shown you before. And then after I've done that, then Joe Benjamin, as I mentioned, will talk to you a little bit about the habitat connectivity work that we're doing as part of the GMLCC project. So we had another stakeholders meeting, and this one resulted in a very similar conceptual model to what we had seen in the ACMA. So a little bit maybe smaller in scale, and this may be because the Methow River Basin is a little bit smaller in scale than is the Yakima. But we are hoping to be able to put together linkages between these red circled areas to link climate change to a variety of water uses and climate into maximizing economic benefits. Ultimately, what our goal is in this is to complete this modeling work and put together a decision support tool that can be used by stakeholders in that Methow River Basin, and we're hoping to complete that this year or early in 2013. What I'd like to do now is to share a little bit about how this modeling and this user-friendly modeling will be available to these stakeholders, and this will be available either online or through a locally controlled computer at one of the sites in the Methow. This is the dashboard of that user-friendly decision support tool. And beginning up in the upper left corner, people will have ability to make decisions about what kind of storage projects might be put into it. There are scenarios, climate change scenarios, that are all part of what was developed by the University of Washington Climate Impacts Group. There, people can make estimates as to how the population in the area might change through time. And also those in the population have a sense of wealth that I might change. Select a variety of fish species and look at available habitat for those fish. And also look at human recreation available in the area. Finally, decisions can be made by the agricultural interest in terms of how many acres are planted and the choice of irrigation systems and a variety of other things that can be plug in here. And finally, a user can select whatever kind of output they would like, pushing a calculation button, and get output from this model. That can include such things as habitat, which we've selected here. This gives you a little idea of the kind of output that would come from this model. And this is a Monte Carlo simulation model, so there is some variability in it. But in this case, we've asked the model to give us the mid value for juvenile rearing of Chinook salmon in the mid Methow River, and the horizontal axis is the day of the month, meaning January through December, and also the lines indicate either current conditions or each of the 23 out conditions that we have in the model. As you can see, there are changes in terms of the amount of juvenile rearing available in the middle Methow River, depending on how far into the future we live. Some instances, there's an increase in that habitat at certain times of the year. Flows maybe are changing, but in other times of the year, there's. So this is significant in terms of looking also at when rearing is most important to these fish in the middle of that. So we're in the process, as I indicated, of finishing up with this model, and we hope to have it available for the stakeholders in the net allocation within the next 6 to 8 months. As I mentioned earlier, we're hoping to, actually I didn't mention earlier, but our view of this work is to try and link together our work with the work that's being completed by several other groups throughout the Columbia group, and to hopefully at some point be able to link these together so we can put together a model similar to the one we're doing in the Nut House that will be available for the Columbia reservation as a whole. And with that, I'd rather answer any questions you might have at this point in the presentation.
Hi, so my name is Joe Benjamin. I'm a fish biologist here at the Columbia River Research Lab. And what I'm going to talk about today is work in progress, more or less, that was funded in part by the GNLCC, where we're exploring the movement of mountain whitefish in the Mentel River and its connectivity. Okay, so the movement of fish is an important part of component of their life history. Because of this, managers and biologists have spent a lot of time in trying to describe or evaluate their movement. And this is apparent with the wealth of information for anadromous fish. But for those fish that remain in fresh waters, the information available is poor. Relatively speaking. However, we do know that these fish migrate across different habitats, including spawning habitats, feeding habitats, and refuge habitats. We're also aware that they have a lot of variation in the size of movement they make, ranging from short-scale movement, where they never leave their natal stream, more extensive movement, where they move through the waters. And this variation that's important for the viability and the resiliency of these life histories of many of these animals, and it brings up an important point that managers and biologists need to be aware of these complex life histories and the habitats that are used to appropriately conserve these species. Monitoring movement has been difficult in the past, but technology is definitely advancing and allowing us to do this better. Much of them are quantitary and odorless chemistry. Telemetry can be a relatively affordable way to detect a whole lot of fish, particularly if you use with more of a remote sensing type methodology. This would include deploying a passive integrated transponder tag or a FIT tag into a fish, and as it moves past an antenna, a data logger hooked to that antenna will record the time and the date and the unique ID number for that fish. And the Mentel River, which is located in north central Washington, is well equipped with these tag interrogators for antennas. Map is kind of busy, but really what I want you to get out of it is there's a whole lot of interrogators in the Mentel that allows us to track the lateral movement of fish into floodplains and tide channels, as well as longitudinal movement of fish as it moves up and down. And this graph just kind of summarizes what we have in there. Basically, in the main stem reaches, we have about 5 interrogators present, and I think we're going to be deploying another 1 or 2. In 6 smaller tributaries of the Mentel, we have at least 1 antenna present. We also have antennas present in 10 of the side channels to detect the movement of fish in these habitats. And finally, we're coupling these with full traps and weirs that are run in large part by the WDCSW, the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. And these ones are, full traps and weirs are important because they allow us to get not only detect the fish tag in the fish, but actually get size and weight of the fish as well. So there are some limitations to telemetry, a couple being they're not 100% efficient all of the time. And another one, we're really unsure where the fish is going once it passes the antenna. The second approach is analyzing the chemical signatures in odolith, which are more or less ear bones of the fish. These odoliths are nice because they grow with this, they can get daily and annual readings, much like on a tree. Also, these photos will record daily environmental chemistry of where the fish has been. So assuming that the habitats these fish are moving to are different in their chemical makeup, you can map out kind of the path these fish have taken over time. However, you do have to sacrifice the fish to obtain the ocean, which could be a problem for some of these fish that are endangered. What we did is we used these two complementary approaches to assess the life history and the movement of mountain whitefish. So, a lot of people have asked me, why are you studying mountain whitefish? Well, first two points are, you know, they're present in a lot of places, and when they are present, they're usually quite abundant. In the Mattel River, we're conducting snorkeling surveys on a gradient of temporal scales from biweekly to annually. The map up here shows the locations of our snorkeling reaches. And this red dot is where this data is coming from. We'll just kind of walk you through. On the x-axis is the sampling date. Y-axis is the number of fish. Gray bars are whitefish numbers that were observed by the snorkelers. These other bars are for other salmonids, including Chinook salmon, steelhead, West Coast cutthroat trout, and bull trout. The most striking thing from this graph is that whitefish be five times or more abundant, or the numbers are five times or more, than those of the other salmonids. Also, a thing to point out is that there is some temporal variability in the numbers of these whitefish. Another point is that whitefish are relatively understudied. We did a quick Google search to see how many publications were for these different salmonid species that are present in the Mekau since 1980. What I found is basically there's 13 times more publications at the minimum than the exposure of mountain whitefish. And when you start looking at Chinook salmon, there's much more. So I guess given that they are present in a lot of places, they are usually in higher numbers, that we really should be understanding a little bit more of their ecological role and how they interact with these other species that we're more concerned with, I guess. So finally, whitefish can be thought of as a white rat, and with getting permits to work on them is pretty minor compared to getting permits to work on some of these listed species. So we had a range of questions we asked. The first being, do mountain whitefish exhibit migration from the Mattau to the Columbia River? And if they do, when are they migrating? What proportion of the population is migrating? How long are they spending in the Columbia River? And what is the relative growth of the migrants versus those that don't migrate? For the purposes of this talk, I'm just going to concentrate on these first three questions because, as president, that's all the data we have to show. Our methods included collecting fish and seines that were dragged downstream by snorkelers. You might be able to see the net here. These occurred in these locations here. We also collected fish in screw caps and weirs. All fish collected were hit tags, and tails were collected for aging. So far, we've aged about 45 fish. The next map shows where our hit tag interrogators are. And for the purposes of this talk, I'm really going to concentrate on this one down here by the Columbia River, where we're assuming if fish move past it, they're moving into the Columbia. And one other thing I want to point out is all these interrogators have two rose antennas, so we're able to detect the direction of it. And we collected otoliths from 75 fish in six locations, shown with these black stars. And we used strontium isotopes to detect the movement between the Mattau and the Columbia River. And strontium isotopes have been proven to be useful in other freshwater. So we didn't think they would, but we figured they would be useful here. Also, strontium, the signature in the otolith is relatively similar to that in the ambient water. What we did is we we polish the otoliths down to its core or the primordia, that age the fish based on the banding, might be the numbers alongside which represent the age. And from here, we went to the tech lab to their laser ablation machine to analyze the strontium transects on the otoliths, on here with the white line. And then lastly, we collected water samples from all these locations where the otoliths were collected, as well as within the community. So our first graph is basically a length frequency graph of the size of the fish around the x-axis when they were tagged. What I want to get out of this is that most of the size groups of mountain whitefish were accounted for in our sampling. Based on our scales and otoliths, we were able to estimate the average size of these fish by age, which is shown with these red or purplish squares. So another thing to point out is that we had all fish from ages 2 to about 13, suggesting that most of the age groups were also accounted for. So moving into what our tags shows. And to walk you through this figure, on the x-axis here, the month and the year, detections were where fish were detected. And on the y-axis, the number of fish detected. The negative values are those downstream movements where we assume fish were moving into the Columbia River. And the positive values are upstream movements where the fish were moving into the Columbia River. These black bars here are fish where we're unsure of the direction of their movement. The blue bars are fish where we're assuming the direction based on either seasonality or the timing of the year, or they were detected in another antenna or interrogator within a 3-week period. And then these red bars, we know the direction of it. That's the casting antenna. What we're finding is that there does seem to be a seasonal migration pattern of mountain whitefish, where they're moving downstream in the fall, early fall, I guess, in August and September, September and October, and moving upstream in the spring, peaking in March. Some of these fish also move long distances, 80 kilometers or more, in a one-way direction. And we are finding that some of these fish are moving, they move year after year. So, one problem with this data is that even though they're moving downstream past that lowest antenna, we don't know for sure if they're moving. We're assuming they are, but this is where the goal is coming. First, our water samples, coming from the Metau and the Columbia, find that there are significant differences between our two water samples. So we're to be able to detect the differences. Our sample is in red. Those from Jessica Miller and colleagues are in blue, from the studies she used to detect movement of Chinook salmon between the Columbia and Metau. Another very much of Columbia. So, I'm going to show you three different patterns we're finding in our own. I want to remind you that these 0.715 is the Columbia signature, and this 0.705 or 4 is the Metcalf signature. And on the x-axis is the distance from the total of 4. From the top graph, this fish does not appear to make any migrations. The middle fish, at least making one migration to the Columbia. And then the bottom fish is making two migrations, at least, with this weird little blip here that we're unsure what it means yet. One thought is that it might be moving down into the mouth of the Metau, where it's still influenced by the Columbia. So the signature may not be as strong, but we're not sure. So if anybody has suggestions, we'll likely entertain them. I reject them, but one thing. Let's see. Okay, but the next question is really, what proportion of the population able to assess this in both, but in both samplings, sampling approaches, you know, the odorless and the tag. So the, on the x-axis, on the top graph, is the number of fish sacrificed by age. They're odorless, and on the bottom is the age of the fish when they were taxed. These are estimates. Many big bars are the total number. And those are the ones I really want you to focus on. So when we overlay the proportion by age of fish migrating, there's a lot of variability by age. But when you look at the overall numbers, they're almost identical at about 17%. And the 17% value might not seem like a lot, but recall in a previous graph, we saw that there could be a lot of whitefish in a section of, for example, there could be up to 1,800 whitefish in a 3 kilometer reef, which would mean about 300 of the fish are migrating. And this doesn't account for the other 80-plus kilometers that might be suitable habitat for whitefish, where they could migrate from. So from there, we were wondering, well, if they were going to migrate once, what's the probability of them migrating? Found about 45% of the fish make repeat migrations if they migrate once. So we used a logistic regression to analyze the probability of repeat migrations based on the fork length of the fish when it was tagged and the distance it is from the Columbia River, which is what these different color points mean. What we found is that the bigger the fish, the more likely they are to migrate each time. And those fish closer to the Metau or closer to the Columbia River are more likely to repeat, show repeat migration. And I guess I'll point out that we did do the diagnostics for the regression test, and it worked good. So, what are some of the fecal misses that I showed you? First is that, you know, we combine two complementary approaches, the odorless and telemetry. It appears to be pretty useful in understanding life history and movement of mountain white. We're finding that about 20% of the population was removing. And of those 20%, about half of them are showing recent migration. And as I said in the beginning of the talk, this variation in life history that's really important for the resiliency of the population, especially if climate change or other disturbances. Some of the next steps we plan on taking with the money we have left to, on this study is to estimate the growth of fish while they're in the Meta or while they're in the Columbia River and compare that to growth of fish that did not migrate during the same time and a similar age. We can do this a couple ways, one being back calculations from the odorless, but we can also couple that with bioenergetic models. It may allow us to better estimate it. Bioenergetic models could also be used for assessing the response of whitefish to increasing temperature going to climate change. We've used a similar approach for estimating the life history expression of pomycus, or those fish that express either a rainbow trout or a steelhead life. But finally, fish tag detections are showing that some fish will move out of larger tributaries into the main stem metal, but not make subsequent migrations into the Columbia River. So we'd like to some of the trace elements that are different in the different tributaries of the metal to understand these migrations as well. Some of the things we'd like to do in the future, the opportunity would be to really assess where in the Columbia River these migrants are going and what their food web interactions are. The food web interactions would really complement some of the work done by Ryan Belmore on the fish community in the Metau River. Another thing we'd like to do is begin to understand what the ecological consequences of migrants might be. For example, whitefish could be recycling a lot of nutrients from the Columbia River into the Metau, minor fish are growing bigger when they're something, which would then like competitive advantage when they come back into their fields, maybe stream. And on top of that, starting to understand what the ecological consequences are of large migratory predators. Basically, if they're getting big in the Columbia and then coming back and chowing down on other fish, that might be important. So with that, I'll acknowledge all these folks and take questions if there are.
Okay. Then the next speaker is Joe Benjamin, who will tell you a little bit about what we're hearing in the Met House specifically.
Let's go back to the slide. I thought it was interesting that the older fish looks like there's a smaller proportion of the older fish that, you know, 8-plus fish that are moving. Did you find that interesting, and what do you think might...
Well, I find it interesting for the oldest. All the fish migrating here migrated in the past. They might, these fish migrated up. Fish here are migrating sometimes. So these fish could be migrating at least.
I see.
Calculated that. So another question was, have I made any effort to correlate their movement with environmental conditions? I started playing with that, but didn't have anything well prepared. Basically, right now, focusing on discharge, but also considering other aspects of individual pollution as well as water. Well, I think that's it. Does somebody over there have a question?
No, I'm not seeing any hands raised, and there are no questions in the question box. Well, thank you so much. And as you mentioned, if anybody has any questions afterwards, they can certainly email you.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Great. Thank you so very much.